my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and hear proclaim. My God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God,
afternoon. I want to start with a story of an elder in a church who he had a dream one night about all these people telling them, y'all are doing such a great work, but the work was always what they did in another country. And then he found himself talking to God on Judgment Day, and God asked, what did you do to spread my message? And he said, well, we did this great thing in this other country. We did this great mission work, but he said, what did you do in your city? What did you do in your home to spread my word? And after that, he goes to his other elders in the church, and he tells them, we need to change. I can't be a shepherd of the Lord's church and not be equipping the saints to be evangelists, to spread the word themselves. And he had a goal. The first year, we're going to have 200 Bible studies. Evangelistic Bible studies. And all the elders in that room laughed at him. They said that could not be done. So that year alone, with the help of three others, they did 245 Bible studies. So the next year, he came back to him again. He said, this year, we're going to do 600 Bible studies. And not a single person in that room said a word. Crickets. Because they knew what he did the year before. And that year alone, they did 460. They missed the mark, but they doubled from the year before. And from this difference in shaping the mind and the culture of the church, it has created the congregation that evangelizing me into the church, that knew we have to go out, we have to teach people the gospel. If we truly love them, that's what we'll do. So today, I want to talk about my mission work, but before I do, there's some terms that we need to look into. So the first term is going to be evangelism. Often we think of it as this word that there's so many things that go into it. We might think of well-known evangelists that we know in our life and think, man, I can never be like this guy. Or people in the Bible, like Paul, I could never be like him. But the beauty of it is you don't have to be. God made you the way you are, and that's how you should do your evangelism. It doesn't have to be all these things of you have to give the best speeches, you have to do the best Bible studies. But evangelism falls under a very wide umbrella that we all can work together. Because the way I'll interpret it in this lesson today is the act of using your life to contribute to the growth of the kingdom of God across all facets. So it can be including your work, your hobbies, your home life. All these things can be used to grow the kingdom of God. It doesn't have to be this complicated ordeal. So the next term is the Great Commission. It's worth noting that the specific term does not come verbatim in the Bible. Man put this term on the Bible, which I'm glad they did, because I think we needed this emphasis on it. It was coined around the mid-16th century, popularized in the 18th century. And my intention in highlighting this is to make us consider, if modern churches were to label passages in the Bible, would we give the same, importance and gratitude to this verse? Would we call this the Great Commission? Would we have this in such high severity and such high notice in our churches? Or would we simply pass it as something I know I can do better, like fasting? We read it, we know we have to do it, but I'll work on it when I get there. We know this Great Commission. Some people might say, well, this is just to the apostles. But like Bryce read, this is to all of us afar off. God is always with us. And we're the most important people in the world to God. He could have chose any way to spread his message, but he chose us. So don't neglect the gifts that are inside of you, the things that you can do for God. Because we see so many times in churches nowadays, we lose our focus. Because our mission should line up with God's mission. And when we're not doing that, we're not feeding ourselves spiritually. We're not doing the things, and we're going to seek elsewhere to find that spiritual growth and spiritual fulfillment. But studying the Bible with someone that is hungry for the word is the most spiritually fulfilling thing in the world. Just like 1 Timothy 4, at the end of that passage, talks about taking heed to doctrine, teaching these things. It'll save yourself and those who hear you. And saving yourself is very important in that part. And because God knows if we're constantly teaching these things, we're not going to forget it. You look at the Israelites, they constantly, from the time they were born, they had to be taught the Torah. Like we in class, luckily I know a better way to how to say that, it's the teachings. So they had to be taught. But Christians, like the Bible talks about, we're not born into Christianity. We can be born in a Christian home, but now it's not always just going to be taught your whole life. You have to go and seek these things. You have to go and find what God wants you to do. So presently, we tend to make the Great Commission towards this missiological approach. The Great Commission only is in terms of mission work. That's the Great Commission. But I feel like this poses a significant concern to all of us if we think of it, because the Great Commission is the essence of Christianity. It's the whole point. If you truly love someone, you're going to do this. All this, for example, on our way to Tanzania, there was a church there. I don't know the denomination, but they said, we're going to go and build houses in the name of the Lord. And I just thought about that my whole trip. I wonder how many Bible studies did they have? Did they just, in 20 years, in 30 years, or 50 years, is that house going to still be for the Lord? Or is it just going to be a place where someone lives that might not ever know the truth? Because they didn't teach them. They expected the physical things to get you to the spiritual things. But going back on that, it's the essence of Christianity. It's what brings us all together. All of us, we know we're flawed, but we have God now, because we're not looking for here. And we have such a great tool of each other, because being able to come to your brother and tell him you're struggling, because shame dies when told in a safe place. And I'm just so grateful that we have people that we can talk to about our issues, because there's nothing more than I want is heaven, and I don't want anything to hold me back. And we see in Genesis, it says, talking to Cain, you can rule over sin. It's not impossible. You can conquer these things, and you shouldn't let them conquer you. So don't suffer in silence. But also remember, we got to grow the church. That's what God wants us to do. And I emphasize all these points because not that a mission trip made me an evangelist, or going on mission trips makes you an evangelist. It's how you view things. Because if I'm just an evangelist 1 week a year on a mission trip, I don't think that's what God wants me to be. God wants me to bring that home. You're on fire for the Lord, but don't lose it. If you want to stay on fire, you got to keep teaching people. Nothing has brought me more joy, and nothing has made me reassure my faith more than being able to just teach people the gospel. Because the beauty of it is, we know not everybody's going to obey, but it's not hard to understand. You just have to be honest with yourself that I need God and that he's real. So if we can go ahead and go to the first photos for me. So this is in Tanzania. You don't meet a stranger in Tanzania. If you don't pick up on Swahili while you're there, you have not probably met a single person, because they all will want to greet you. They all want to meet you. This is outside of one of the bomas. They actually have a scarecrow in the yard with an army helmet. We were like, what's that for? Because scarecrows for us are for birds. Theirs are for hyenas. So that was very interesting. We sat there on their yard, drank chai tea, and looked at the mountains, which is like a painted landscape. It was unreal to see God's creation that way. And this is in Namanga. So we're surrounded by four mountains, and if you look to your east, you see Mount Kilimanjaro, the largest mountain in Africa. You can see there's the ice caps on top. We can go to the next one. So those kids, they've never seen someone with hair like on their arms and straight hair like mine, so they really loved playing with it. It was very funny. This is actually still in Namanga. It's right on the Kenyan border. They actually share the border. And this is where we'd go to baptize people. So we would drive up probably about 15 minutes from the church. And all these kids here, they'd be swimming there. And we'd baptize them. Sometimes the kids would basically play pretend baptizing each other while they're watching us doing it. It's just a beautiful country. And the people are very godly there. They're very honest. It's not this football team mentality. It's what the Bible teaches is what we do. And we eventually converted two or three Pentecostal churches while we were there, because leaders from those churches would come listen to our studies. And they said, this is the truth. We need to go teach our family. We need to go teach our church. And they're just so honest. And it's a beautiful thing to see. If you go to the next. So this is Mwanza. So this is going further west, and this is Lake Victoria, the largest lake in Africa, and it was just beautiful. It goes farther than you can see. There are some little islands in between, and we're studying right here on the shore of Mwanza at a fish market. We started there because we were going to go help, because we're building up churches in the area, and we decided there's a fish market here. Why not just start here while we're waiting for this preacher to show up? And we start teaching one guy. And when you find one, sooner or later, 30, 40, 50 will be around you just listening. They want to know what you're teaching. Because unfortunately, they're not wealthy enough to all afford their own Bibles. And we'd be on the shore there. They'd raise their hand while we're studying, asking questions. the same questions that we have here in the States. And they said, I want to be baptized. So we'd study with them, make sure they fully understood. And there's just nothing more beautiful than that. It's breathtaking to see the stones there, to see all the, just like I said, the beauty of God. And we can go to the next. This is going to be in Honduras, La Esperanza in Tibucá. This is the church building. And you can see there it might fit maybe 20 people comfortably. And this is the group that went with us. We had about 9 churches represented, I believe. And in those 5 days alone, we did about 600 prescriptions. It was a medical mission. But we helped them physically, but most importantly, we loved them, so we helped them spiritually. So out of those 600 people, we studied with 350 of them that in those 5 days. The work was, it was amazing to see. We can go to the next photos and you'll see kind of the studies. So we had these tables, there's some behind me here, the ones in front of me, and this person right here studying, this is one of our shepherds on the left. Kirk Brothers might actually know the guy on the right. He's from Panama, and his brother was also there, Carlos. And the young man in the middle, he currently is not in the church yet, but he is, that elder, is he's dating his granddaughter, and we've been teaching him the gospel. So after 3 days, he said, I can study. I can teach someone. So now we have him teaching and helping with the translator teach that woman the gospel. And it's just powerful to see. And then the next photo will show inside. This is the all the medical stuff in the back and the doctors and more studies. And all these people, we asked them after, would you like to study? That's all we did. No pressure. And we'd have either 5 minutes or 2 hours with them. Some people would show up every day, and they just wanted to keep studying the Bible. I don't like to get mixed up into the baptisms, because of course that's God's doing, but the 350 Bible studies alone is just beautiful and quite the follow-up plan for that church. And so many leaders over there have volunteered to continue to go back to La Esperanza to help with all the follow-up. And I say all this to say, of course you don't have to be on a mission trip to be an evangelist, but if you really want to just give a week or 3 weeks to the Lord to just learn how to study the Bible. Because like I said, the questions they have in Honduras, the questions they have in Tanzania, are the same questions that people here in America have. And you're able to actually listen and learn how to answer these questions with the Bible and give really easy illustrations that make sense. Because illustrations in America don't work in Tanzania. So we really have to simplify it and be versatile in that way as well. So if you're willing, the Kensington Woods Church of Christ is willing to invite anyone to come on these mission trips with us just to see it. And you will, based off all the people that came with us, you will go back to your home church with a new perspective on evangelism. You will be more confident in doing Bible studies. And you're going to light a fire, hopefully, in your home congregation to be more evangelistic, because this is what God wants us to do. So you got to ask yourself, would I give Matthew 28, would I regard it as the Great Commission? Or would I just regard it as just more doctrine in the Bible? So, and also I give, not just to give an opportunity, but some encouragement. If you're here, if you have family, just as myself, that's not in the church, if you have friends, if you have roommates, if you have neighbors, feel free to reach out. So not just me, but anyone here is willing to study the Bible with them. And I don't think we'd have more joy in the world than to do that, to help you, but also to help them, because that's what we got to do. We got to help each other so we can help the world. Thank you.
Bow with me. Lord, we come to you now and we thank you for all many blessings that you've given us. Lord, we thank you for Taylor. We thank you for the message that he's given us this morning. Lord, we ask that you You give us all of us in this room the strength to stay within your will and to go out and to get out of our comfort zone, Lord, and evangelize to those that need it and to those that we might deem that might not need it, Lord. Lord, we thank you for this school. We thank you for all the students who have cut out a portion of their life, Lord, to come and study your word and to be more effective ministers. Lord, we thank you for the staff here that have cut out a larger portion of their life, that they're dedicated to helping us achieve those goals, Lord. We're thankful for all those people here. Lord, we ask that as this semester continues, that we all grow in you. We all grow to one another. Lord, we ask that any walls between any of us, whether they be social or whatever they might be, to cut those down, Lord, so that we can all come together as one group of believers and have a more effective evangelism as a school, Lord. Lord, we thank you ultimately for your son's sacrifice on the cross for all of our sins, knowing each and every sin every one of us in this room would ever commit. Lord, we ask that you give us the strength to wake up every morning with the intent of not letting his sacrifice be in vain. And it's in your son's holy name that we all humbly pray. Amen.